And we are going to work through a few activities, and then you're going to see there's a few activities that's going to be left over for you to do on your own. And I really want to encourage you to work through these activities on your own, because as we all know, that is the only and the best way to do well in accounting and also to pass accounting. So I'm going to just ask you to keep your eye on the chat and also to keep your eye on the clock, because we have limited time and I don't want to waste it. We will have a 15-minute break after the first two activities that I worked through, but I'm really on a tight time for each question. So could you please just remind me? I would really appreciate it. Thank you. Okay, so learners, what we're going to do is we're going to work through a few of these topics that we identified that you still need a little bit of assistance with. Now, one of the first topics that we're going to look at will be your statement of comprehensive income. And that is a paper one topic, as you all know. So we're going to go through that first. So you can go for me to this beautiful answer sheet, which is question one. And it is the statement of comprehensive income. And at the same time, I'm also going to open up our information booklet, our material. So you might see this, you might not, but I'll just write over it again with pen, because I obviously also had to prepare myself this morning, or actually yesterday, for this lesson. Learners, one of the biggest things that I can tell you when it comes to statement of comprehensive income, and I'm very sure your own teachers also emphasize this, is the fact that you need to know your format. You really need to know your format. So, and also another thing that is super important is you need to read carefully. You need to read carefully. Everything that is stated here is so important for you, and you need to read it. Okay, so let's start. They tell us here, you are provided with information extracted from the records of Big Save Limited on the 30th of April, 2003. Okay, so there's our first thing that's super important, this date. Now, why is this date important? Because we need to know when the financial year ended. I'm going to ask you, as always, and I'm sure your teachers also always tell you to draw yourself a timeline. Now, if our financial year ended on the 30th of April, 2023, that means this financial year started the 1st of May, 2022, and it obviously will therefore end the 30th of April, 2023. They tell me here, I am required to prepare the statement of comprehensive income for the year ended 30 April 2023. So in front of us here, you will see there is an information section. The first section, or A, is the extract from the pre-adjustment trial balance, and you're going to see there's a number of amounts here. It can be amounts out of the balance sheet section of the trial balance or the nominal section of the trial balance. And then later on, there's also a few adjustments. Now, I want to give you a tip over here. As you all know, when you start your exams, you have 10 minutes to read through your paper before you start with the paper. And do yourself that favor, start reading through these adjustments, because as you read, your mind is already working out the answers. And yes, we know we cannot make any notes, but we can make little notes in our minds before we start. Okay, so let's see. They tell us here goods are sold at a markup of 40% on cost price. So I wrote this year for a reason. I said, given for a reason. They give you this for a reason, okay? Because they want you to go and work out something a bit later on. Now, let's read the next adjustment or the next piece of information. Before we do, I just want to highlight that for you. You know, I always use my highlighters. And I also want to encourage you to do the same when you are in exam. An allowance for stock totally damaged. Now, totally damaged means that we cannot take the stock back to resell again in our own business, right? So it is not returned to the business at all. So that means we can't sell it. We can't sell it again. The value of the stock according to the original invoice received was 12,000 Rand. Now, this 12,000 Rand is your cost of sales. But you received or you allowed you granted the allowance for a customer, right? And not any specific customer. It could have been a cash customer. It could have been a debtor. But you granted the allowance because it was totally damaged. Now, take note, a client can return stock because it was maybe the incorrect stock or it is completely damaged. When it is completely damaged, we are not going to work with the cost of sales amount. So we're not going to indicate that in our cost of sales. I'm just making a note here. Why? Because the stock is not coming back into our stock room. So let's work with that first. But now, as I mentioned earlier, number one was given to us for a reason. They gave us this because we now need to go and work out the selling price because this is the cost price. So they want to know what is the selling price. And I'm very sure many of you have already started working that out. And I also want to encourage you that when you do your calculations, do everything on the answer sheet given to you. Do not work anything out on your question paper. Because at the end of the day, when the markers mark your papers, they want to go and look for marks to assist you. And if you don't show any calculations on here, you're going to lose out on unnecessary marks where you could have gained some. So the first thing what we're going to do is we are going to write down the sales amount that we currently have. So here's the sales amount that you currently have. We're going to quickly write that down. So it is 7164000. And I'm sure you also noticed that there is already debtor's allowance. And I know that you already know that this must be deducted from my sales amount. So there's already a mark that you're going to get by showing that you are deducting the 84,000. And remember, learners, today is also about identifying the easy marks. We want you to get the easy marks without even blinking, okay? That you know that you're definitely going to pass the paper and pass it confidently. Now, as I said, they gave us the selling, the cost price, but we want to get the selling price. So how do I do that? And this is a very old calculation, but I run through it for you again. So we are looking for SP, right? I don't know if your teachers taught you this, but this is what I taught my learners. SP is equal to 100 plus the markup percentage, and cost price is always equal to 100. So cost price stands on its own. It doesn't have a friend. And we are going to work with what you want over what you have. And you're going to multiply it with the amount made available to you. So I'm going to quickly make this calculation for you. As I said, we're looking for the selling price. So 100 plus 40 gives you 140 over 100. Multiply it with the amount that has been provided to you, which is 12,000. And the amount that you are looking for, the selling price amount that you are looking for, is 16,800. Now, this 16,800 must be deducted. Okay? Must be deducted. Why? Because we have granted that allowance. We allowed that debtor or that client to not have to pay that amount at all. So I'm going to deduct it here. 16,800. Now, learners, this should have been an easy few marks that you could have gotten right there. So our final answer over there should be 7,063,200. And I'm sure you have your calculators with you. Right. Okay. Easy stuff, right? Next up, while we are here, let's write in the cost of sales amount, which is 3,840,000, and we're going to put it in brackets because we need to deduct that amount. After deducting that amount, you're going to find that your answer for the gross profit is 3,223,200. Again, easy stuff. Easy stuff, and that is what we are concerned about today. We want to get those easy marks. Now let's move on. Okay, let's see what do they say here at number three. On the 30th of April 2023, 2,800 Rand was received from a quasar whose account had previously been written off as irrecoverable. Now, I want you to stop there. I don't want you to read any further. I just want you to stop there. Because this is what we tend to do, learners, is we just read without taking a breath. So let's deal with the first part of this sentence or of this adjustment first. So what happened? 2,880 Rand was received from a quasar whose account had previously been written off as irrecoverable. So this means we are getting bad, we're going to work with bad debts recovered. And we are receiving that money. And seeing that it is bad debts recovered, it will go to your other operating income. So let's go and record that first. Okay. So again, that's really a given mark for you there. So we're going to write in bad debts recovered. Okay. And 2,880 Rand. Now, I'm very sure most of you were already shouting the answer when you read the first piece. But now this is the problem. Many of you stop there. And we can't stop there because there's a rest, another half of this adjustment that we also need to deal with. If you look at the second sentence, it says here, the amount was entered as bad debts in the cash receipts journal. Now, learners, bad debts is not entered in the cash receipts journal. I know you're going to tell me, ma'am, we're not in grade 10 anymore. I know you're not in grade 10, but you should still know your journals. Because you see, this should have been in the GJ, the general journal. So therefore, this 2,880 Rand that we recorded incorrectly in the CRJ as bad debts needs to be correctly recorded in the GJ. In other words, we're going to add that 2,880 Rand back to bad debts. So where does bad debts go? It's going to go under your operating expenses. So under your operating expenses, you're going to find sundry expenses and you're going to write in bad debts. Now, once again, before you just write the amount in, go and see, do we have previous bad debts? Okay, let's check it out. Yes, there is previous bad debts. So we're going to open our bracket and we're going to write this amount in. Now, learners, I know most of you are on top of your game and you can work all of this out without showing it in a bracket and you can just write the final answer. Now, the problem with that is if you write only the final answer, according to you, you might have gone wrong somewhere. And because of that, that could cause you to lose marks because you see, we look at your final answer, but then we go back and we see, oh, your final answer isn't right. Where did you make a mistake? And hopefully we can still give you a mark. So I really want to encourage you and I want you to build your confidence to show your calculations in brackets. We're going to start with 14,520 because that's our pre-adjustment trial balance amount. And as I said, this 2,880 was incorrectly recorded in the CRJ as bad debts. As bad debts in the CRJ. But it should have been recorded in the general journal. So that 2,880 Rand must be added back. And that is it. Now you close your bracket and now we can write down our final amount being 17,400. And I think I might be missing. No, I'm not missing anything. There we go. I hope everybody's still with me and that I'm not going too fast, but I'm sure you are keeping up. Okay, let's move on. Right. Number four. Now, learners, when there is bad debts, you can know that the chances of having an adjustment for provision for bad debts, it's almost certain. But the provision for bad debts adjustment will be affected by number three. Okay, it will be affected by number three. Now, they asked me here, the provision for bad debts must be adjusted to 5% of outstanding debts. Now, outstanding debts is basically your debtors, okay? Where do I get my total debtors? I go to debtors control. If you go to your debtors control here at the top, you will see that currently we have debtors of, the total debtors of 625,600, right? That is our outstanding debtors. But we need to deduct the current bad debts, right? So we're going to start there. Again, I'm going to squeeze in the space here and just do a small calculation for you. We start with 625,600. So that's your debtors control. And then you are going to deduct the amount of your current bad debts. Now, you just calculated bad debts, so we're going to deduct that. Because remember, as it looks now, we're not going to get this amount back, and we need to work with the net trade debtors. So we're going to deduct that amount, which is 17,400. You will then be left with 608,160. Now, this 608,000, you multiply that with 5%. And I know some of you are saying, ma'am, we know this. I know you might know this, but it's always good to run through it again, just to make you even stronger. We're going to use our calculator and we're going to calculate what they want us, the bad debts to be adjusted, provision for bad debts to be adjusted to. So they want us to adjust it to 30,408. Okay. Now, this is where the big thing comes in. You see, provision for bad debts goes hand in hand with provision for bad debts adjustment. And that provision for bad debts adjustment account can either be an income or it can be an expense. Now, how do we know it needs to be or it will be an income or an expense? We need to see if our current provision for bad debts needs to increase to this amount. The difference is an expense. If this amount is less than our current provision for bad debts, then it will be an income. So let's go see what is it currently. Okay, we're going to go back to our information. We're going to go to bad debts, provision for bad debts, 26,400. And they want us to adjust it to 30,408. So that means we need to put more money aside for possible bad debts. The difference between those two amounts will be, in this case, an expense for this company. Okay? So I'm going to quickly put that in brackets for you and write it in. So we have it here, provision for bad debts, adjustment. Okay, my space is a little bit limited, but I'll make it work. So this is what they want us to change it to, 30,408. But currently our provision for bad debts is 26,400. So we're going to deduct the 26,400 because we are looking for the difference. We are looking for the difference, and that difference being 4,008 rand. Okay, now I'm going to just stand still here for a moment. Learners, if you go and you go and look at the adjustments we have done so far, these are really easy to moderate marks that you can earn. And I really want to remind you that some of these adjustments we've been doing since grade 10 and grade 11. So I want you to remind yourself, but I know this. I can do this because I was able to do it in grade 10 and 11. And I know I can do this because I've done it a few times. So let's move on. Now, here things you might feel, oh, ma'am, this one, you know, it's a little bit complicated, but I'm going to show you an easy way how to get these marks. Okay, let's see, what do they want from us? The next adjustment, yeah. Now, the company has three directors. Let's quickly highlight that. The company has three directors, each earning 44,600 per month. The third director was only appointed on the 1st of November 2022. Now, it's very important here to now go back to your timeline, you see? And that is why we have been on your case since grade 10 to draw your timeline. So that is exactly what I'm going to take you back to. Here is our timeline. Now, if you look at the timeline, you will notice that November 2022 falls round about more towards the end, round about there. And they say this person was appointed on the 1st of November. So now we're going to count. So we're going to say November, December, January, February, March, April. So that means 6 months. This director has been working in our company for 6 months. Okay. So we're going to write that down. We're going to write that down, and I'm going to do it here on the side. The one director has been working in the company for 6 months. Okay. Then the other two directors, Director 2 and Director 3, they have been here the whole 12 months for this financial year, and I'm very sure you would agree with me, right? Now, learners, all together, how many months did they actually work? If we add all these months for each director together, you're going to find that it is 30 months, okay? So we need to work out for how many months we paid them. But in actual fact, this is how many months we should have. We should have paid them. So let's go test. Let's go see. Did we pay them for all these months? So we're going to go to our pre-adjustment amounts. Here we go. Director's fee, 1,248,800. We know this is how much we paid. We should have paid them for 30 months. So we're going to take 30 months and we're going to just multiply it with the rate per month that we pay each of these directors. And we're going to find the amount we should have paid. 44,600 multiplied by 30. That gives us 1,338,000. And okay, so this is what we should have paid. But now let's go compare it with what we have paid. And what we have paid is 1,248,800. Aha. Okay, so there we go. We have not paid them in full. So therefore, this is going to adjust, be an adjustment of accrued expenses. And you know by now that accrued expenses must be added. So accrued expenses is everything I should have paid in this financial year. But however, I have only paid that amount at the moment. Okay. So we're going to write in director's fees. We are going to start with the pre-adjustment amount. If you want to, you can actually already go and write in what we should have paid. So what we just calculated, there's the amount we should have paid. So you can go and write that in and then just work backwards. But it's all up to you. If you want to start with writing it your your adjustment in the brackets first. That's no problem. So we're going to write this in 1, 2, 4, 8, 800. Okay. And what is the amount that we need to add? The amount that we need to add is 8, 9, 200. Now, there's another way that we can also do this. We could have also said that you take this amount, 1, 2, 4, 8, 800, and you divide it by 44,600. Because that can tell you exactly how many months you paid. 1, 2, 4, 8, 800 divided by 4, 4, 600. And it tells you 28 months. But you can test it and you can see, oh, but we should have paid for 30 months. So we are in arrears, or we have accrued expenses of 2 months. So this amount is equal to 2 months, okay? I'm going to close that bracket. So learners, one bite at a time. Don't overcomplicate it for yourself. And the fact that you know that this is accrued expenses and it needs to be added, that symbol, already knowing that symbol, is a plus for you. Remember, accrued expenses and accrued income must be added because it is part of the current financial year. It is everything I should have received and everything I should have paid. Right, next. Moving. Okay. Next one. The following were reflected during a physical stock count on the 30th of April 2023. Trading stock of 1,847,800 and consumable stores 600. Now I want us to focus on the trading stock first. So basically we went into our storeroom at the end of the financial year and we counted all the stock that was left over in our stockroom, and we calculated the value. And the value, according to a physical stock check, was 1,847,800. And then we went and we compared it with the records we have. The records we have says that we have stock to the value of 1,840,800. You are going to see that is a difference of 7,000 Rand. But more stock than according to our books. So the fact that there's more stock than according to our books shows us that it's a trading stock surplus. A trading stock surplus is good for us. It's seen as an income, and we're going to go and write that in. So we're going to go here to your other operating income. We're going to fill in trading stock surplus. And please do remember, you can't just write trading stock. Why can you not just write trading stock? Because trading stock is an asset account. In this statement, learners, we don't want to see any assets or liabilities at all. Because this is purely for income and expenses. So the moment we say trading stock surplus, we understand that this is an income account. So you're going to write a little bracket for yourself, and you're going to start with this amount over here, the amount after we did the physical stock check of 1,000,000 847,800. And we're going to deduct the amount that we have in our books of the 1,840,000. 1,840,800. And you're going to see, and I know you are shouting it to your teachers, it's 7,000, and you are 100% right. Okay, awesome stuff. Well done. I'm sure you got that one right. And I am going to give you an opportunity to prove yourself to me. Okay, now we've looked at this one. Nice, done. Here we go, the next one. Now learners, yeah, when they tell you that consumable stores to the value of 600 Rand was left over. I wrote it here as well. So this is what is left over. Now, I always, my learners know, and they're already so irritated with me. I always use my whiteboard markers as an example. Okay? So let's say, for example, at the beginning of this year, I purchased 4 whiteboard markers, right? And during this year, I used 3 of them. I use them up, they are dry, I throw them in the dustbin. But this one, I haven't touched at all. Can I use it again? Yes, I can. I can use this one again because I have not touched it. I have not worked with it. It is still usable. So I can just keep it for the next year. But this is then seen as my consumable stores on hand. And the ones that I used, this is my true expense. Okay? So I am interested when it comes to consumable stores. What was used is the expense. And I'm going to write it here for you. So what was used? That is the question. Because at the end of the day, what was used is the expense. And I've seen it in past papers, and I'm sure you've seen it as well, that they tell you consumable stores used during the year, and then they give you amount. They actually give you the answer, right? But many of you still go and deduct that. So I really want you to take note and read carefully. So this 600 Rand that was left over, we need to deduct that from the amount that we have in our pre-adjustment trial balance. Why? Because it was not used. And I'm only interested in what was used because that is the expense. And again, I know you're saying, ma'am, we know this. But at the end of the day, sometimes you miss out on the easy marks, and that's what I don't want you to happen, especially in this upcoming exam. So we are going to go back, and we're going to quickly go and put our eyes over here. Consumable stores. So consumable stores of 47,400 was purchased. That is what was purchased. But again, we are only interested in what was used during this financial year. So we're going to write in consumable stores. Okay. And we're going to start with our bracket, 47,400. And we know this 600 Rand worth of consumable stores were left over. And that is my consumable stores on hand. That consumable stores on hand is an asset. So another way to look at it is, as I just mentioned a few minutes earlier, We don't want to have any assets in the income statement. So we're going to take that asset away and we're going to take it to the balance sheet. And then finally, I get the amount that was used. And that is your true expense. And that would be 46,800. Awesome. I hope you have all of that. Okay. I'm going to move on to the next adjustment. And our time is kind of running up with this question, but I'm going to speed it up a little bit. So let's quickly see. Right. Now, learners, here is one of the adjustments, or actually two of them, that these are easy marks. They are easy, easy marks. So this 243,840, right? They tell me depreciation for the year amounted to 243,840. Now, guess what? Guys, this is an easy mark. So what do I do with this? I know my learners will tell me copy and paste. And that is literally what you are going to do. You are going to copy and paste. So we're going to quickly go right in depreciation. Right. And we are going to literally copy and paste 243,840. Copy and paste. Yes, that is a definite mark. Thank you so much. And again, like I said, those are your easy marks. Next up, an amount of 5,600 was paid too much in auditing fees. Okay, so you already know you paid too much, right? So that is expenses prepaid. So prepaid expenses. What do you do with prepaid expenses? That needs to be deducted. That needs to be deducted. I am going to give you a chance in the next adjustment to show me that you are on top of it and you don't actually need me for this extra lesson. So let's just quickly write in 105,600. And remember, like I mentioned, that 5,600, it is not part of the current financial year. It is not part of the current financial year. We should have only paid it in the next financial year. And because we should have only paid it there, it doesn't match, right? So if you take it further, you can talk about the GAAP principles. That comes in handy, which is the matching principle. And we're going to deduct that 5,600. Another easy mark. Good, guys. Okay. So now I'm going to put it to you, right? I think I've spoken enough. I'm going to give you a chance. I am going to give this to you. I would like you to work out for me and answer this adjustment, number 9. So I'm going to put this in your hands. I'm going to give you 3 minutes. And then, sir, if we could just keep an eye on the chat, unless if there are learners that would like to tell us the answers, we can maybe give them a few minutes and then we can hear their voices. Thank you. We're going to give. Okay, right. Do we have any answers? Let's see. Okay. Mr. De Beer, We have here salaries and wages we need to add. And yes, it is, I'm sure it is not just Mr. De Beer. Thank you, sir. It is Delft High. Well done. Delft High, well done. You are on the right track. I am very happy to see that. And I'm just going to run through it with you. We need to add 21,000 to the salaries and wages. And then the employer's contribution, we need to add the 4,410. Now I'm going to quickly run through this just so that we all can see what needs to be done. So well done, Delft. There is a little heart for you from me. Well done, well done. Clearly, you guys don't need me. Okay, so I'm going to quickly run through this with you. And again, learners, it's a situation of reading, 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 reading. Because we just jump in and we don't read. And I know most of you do, but there are one or two of you that don't read. And it's okay because you're going to get stronger and more confident and then you're going to read. Okay, so an employee was omitted. Now, what does this fancy word mean? It means they were left out, okay? Not added, basically, from the salaries journal. He has not been paid yet. Not been paid yet. So accrued expense. Not been paid yet, but he should have been paid. So we know the amounts need to be added. Now, they threw us with a little bit of a curveball here. They gave us the net salary. They gave us the employer's contribution and they gave us the total deductions. Now, learners, I want to remind you, you need to ask yourself, what is the cost to the company? The cost to the company is not the net salary. The cost to the company is the gross salary. And how do I get that? I am going to take my net salary. Oh, net salary. And I'm going to add my deductions. Then I'm going to go back to the gross salary. So I'm not going to add the employer's contribution to that amount. I'm going to add the deductions. And if I add those two together, you're going to find that it is 21,000. That is for the salary. So we're going to go over here. We are going to start off once again with our pre-adjustment trial balance amount. 985. 200, yes, okay. Salaries and wages. Good stuff. Bracket, open your bracket. 985,200. And we're going to add the 21,000. Are we on the right track? Yes, we are. Okay. And again, learners, just by you realizing that this person is missing and he should have been added. It's accrued expenses. We should have paid it. So therefore, we need to add. And I am going to give you the final amount over here being 1,000,000 and 6,200. Okay, I hope we're all happy with that amount. Last but not least is our employer's contribution. Now, please do not forget, employer's contribution is an expense for the company. It is an expense for the company. It's something we do additional. It's how we look after our employees. Now, currently the employees' contribution is the 97,200 and that 4,410 410 Rand that they spoke about over here needs to be added. Also needs to be added. Three. So plus 4410, close the bracket. And we have our final amount over there of 101,610. Okay, brilliant. Now, I am going to again throw it into your court, and I'm going to say, learners, I give you 3 minutes, because remember, it's not just about me teaching today. It is about building your confidence and making sure that you can comfortably go into the exam, because at the end of the day, you need to work on your own. Because unfortunately, myself and your teachers will not be there in the final exam, will just be you, yourself. And hopefully all the voices that's been teaching you over the years. So I'm going to give you 3 minutes, and I would like you to quickly work out number 10. Work out number 10. Let's see who is going to be first. Okay, let's hear it. Morning, Delft.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Morning. Are you well?
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm very glad. I'm well done with confidently saying morning. And let's quickly hear, what is your answer?
Okay, so since there was 2 months in Aries with the rain, meaning the rain wasn't paid, we're going now. And the monthly rain was decreased by 1,000 from 1st of January. We're going to add back the 2 months that the 2,000 that was subtracted, like the, yeah, from July and February.
Yes, you only
back the 2,000, yeah. And then yes, we're going to have, yeah. Then we're going to add back the 2,000 to the 278,000, which will give us 280,000. Then we will divide that by 10 months since 2 months was unpaid. And then that will give us 28,000. Then we will subtract the 1,000 from which will leave us with 27. And then we'll just add it to 37 by two, times 2, and that will give us 54,000.
Wow, well done, well done. That is brilliant. That is the answer. Well done, Dal. You guys can celebrate. I'm very proud of all of you, and I'm sure Mr. De Beers is also very proud of you. Well done, brilliant. Okay, I'm going to quickly just share it with all of my other friends. And right, once again, Dalf, that is brilliant. Thank you, Mr. De Beer. I'm going to quickly run through this for you, and how our friend they explained it at Delft, that is perfectly fine. That's 100% fine. That's correct. So I'm going to quickly share with you how we do that. How do we work that out? Because I know, learners, I know some of you might feel, oh, ma'am, that is a bit of a challenging adjustment. I don't feel comfortable. It's okay. You may feel like that. But I'm here today to really boost your confidence and show you that it is possible. We can do it. Okay. So what she said is we take the current rent income, right, of 278,000. We know that they said here that the rent is in arrears for 2 months. But also we must take note that the rent was decreased by 1,000 Rand on the 1st of January. Now, I know this is slightly unusual because we are used to the rent increasing. So what we're going to do is we're going to add back. We're going to add back that 1,000 times 2. So we're going to add back for 2 months, right? The increase or the decrease to see what the monthly rent was before the decrease. That's going to give us, that's then 2,000 rand, that's going to give us 280,000. So again, this is what the rent was for 10 months before the decrease. And what will we do then? We will divide this by 10 months. We will then find again what was the rent per month before the decrease. 28,000. So what do? I know the rent decreased with 1,000 rand per month from the 1st of January. So all I do is I just go and deduct that 1,000 again. And I'm left with 27,000 rand. And they tell me that we are in arrears for 2 months. Not we, apologies, the tenant is in arrears for 2 months. So this is, of course, accrued income. And remember, accrued income, we need to add the amount because we should have received it. Doesn't mean we have received it, but we should have received it. So that amount we must multiply with 2, giving us 54,000 rand. And this 54,000 rand must be added. Now, learners, I know I went a long route, but I would rather show you the long route and you are comfortable to then do this in the exam, okay? Right, so we're going to quickly go up here. And I'm literally going to just show you number 11 and 12, but I'm going to move on then. And I'm sure you are on top of your game. You'll be able to fill in the other blank spaces because we unfortunately need to move on. But I just would like to quickly show you this in the brackets. So there's rent income. And please, learners, we've also seen this in the exams when we mark your final exams. Be careful. Do not put rent income over here say that it is rent expense. We are going to deduct marks, and we don't want to do that. And again, it's all about reading. The tenant. So the tenant is someone that is renting from you. Okay, it's someone that's renting from you. But as I said, 278,000, we're going to add 54,000 rand. Okay, and we're going to close the bracket. And the total rent we should have received is 332,000. Okay, brilliant. Now, learners, I'm literally going to show you the last two adjustments because I know you've come across this, but you don't necessarily work it out correctly. And I'm going to give you this tip again, what you want over what you have. So they tell me here that net profit after tax, not before tax, net profit after tax amounts to 5% of the sales. Now, learners, take note that if you know your format, you will know that this is the last entry for the income statement. So here at the bottom, here's your net profit for the year. In other words, net profit after tax. This amount is basically 72% because later on, they tell you that income tax is calculated at 28% of the net profit. So we know that this is equal to 28%, and we know that we deduct this. So we just work back up. So your profit before tax is equal to 100%. Right. Now let's first work this one out. We're going to go back to sales. We're going to go back to our sales amount. 5% of this amount will give us the net profit after tax. So I'm going to write, do this calculation for you here. 7,063,200. And we are going to multiply it with 5%, right? And that is going to give you, so 7 million. It's going to give you 353,160. Brilliant. Okay. Now, it's going to be a case of what I want over what I have. Now, it does not matter which one you want, right? Doesn't matter which one you're going to look for here, as long as you know that this is what you have. Okay, so let's say I am going to work out the 28%. So I'm going to say I want the 28, I have the 72, and I'm going to multiply it with the amount that is available to me, 353,160. And do you see I'm showing all my calculations on my answer sheet? So that if you go wrong somewhere, the teacher marking your paper can go and look for marks. Okay, it's going to give me 137,340. And I know this needs to be deducted, but I'm working my way up. I'm working my way up, right? I'm working my way up. So I'm going to take this amount, I'm going to add this back, and then I'm going to get my profit before tax. And that will be 490,500. Okay? I hope this gives you more confidence because you are likely to get something like this. Okay, learners, I'm literally just going to give you a 2-minute break, just for 2 minutes, just that we catch our breath, and then we're going to go to cash flow statement. So take a deep breath and do some stretching, maybe stand up, shake your hands and shake your head and turn around, and then you can sit down again and we're going to move on. So I'm going to give you a minute to just take your breath. Okay, right, here we go. Okay, learners, let's get to the cash flow statement. Again, this is now something that was taught to you for the first time, and this is true to companies. Okay, it's true to companies, and it is so doable. It is really so doable. Now, I want to just give you a few tips. You can get in your cash flow statement questions. They can either ask you to do some of the notes. They can ask you to do a part of the cash flow statement. They can ask you to do note number one, the reconciliation note. But they will always ask you some part of the cash flow. And unfortunately, we cannot flip a coin and we can say, oh, I think this year, at the end of the year, they are going to ask us a full cash flow statement. So I'm only going to focus on the full cash flow statement, the face. We can't do that, learners. None of us, not even myself, not your teachers, even know the exact questions that will be asked, you know, at the end of the year. It is truly a mystery to all of us. So I really want to encourage you to go through as many past papers as you can, because that will help you build your confidence in this question. I'm literally going to look at a few parts here, again, to where we can get the easy questions, the easy marks. I'm not going to spend all my time over here working through everything. I just want us to focus on the easy parts. Okay, now learners, you will see there's obviously 3.1 up to 3.4. This question always goes hand in hand with the financial indicators. They won't necessarily ask you to analyze, but they will ask you to calculate. And this is easy marks. It is easy, easy marks. Okay? So I really want to, you know, encourage you. You know your financial indicators, you know the formulas, you know your formula sheet. Make sure you don't leave these spaces open. Don't leave any open spaces. That calculation that you do might just give you 2 marks, and that 2 marks could be the difference between a pass or it can be the difference between a 50% or a distinction. And we really don't want you to miss out on that. So make sure you don't leave any open spaces. Okay, now let's see. The following information was extracted from the financial records of Applebee Limited, a public company listed on the Johannesburg Security Exchange. The financial year ends annually on the 31st of August. Okay, so that's something important to take note of. They want us to do the following. Prepare the following note to the financial statement. Now, learners, the ordinary share capital note, they can ask you this. They can ask you the retained income note. Why? Because these notes are specifically for companies. It's new this year, something new that you learned. They can ask it in question 3 or in question 2, which is usually the cash flow statement question, or they can ask it in the statement of comprehensive income. They ask you to just do that note or as part of the balance sheet. Okay, so make sure you really get yourself comfortable with this note. Then they also want us to complete the cash flow statement. And then I'm going to skip this guy for now, for today. But I really want to encourage you. This is a bit of internal control. It's a little bit of governance. And I really want you to not leave these open. Please, learners, you don't understand. It's 6 marks. Again, these 6 marks could, you know, if you at least try it, you might get 2 marks. And again, those 2 marks can make a big difference for you at the end of the exams. But we are going to do 3.4. Okay, now let's start quickly with the ordinary share capital note. And you will see that they gave us some information. They gave us the statement of comprehensive income, just a small piece from that. And then they also gave us a small extract from the statement of financial position. And last but not least, on the other side of the page, they gave us some information about the share capital. Now, learners, they also gave you some notes to the financial statements. I am going to go to this part and I'm going to remind you, we are going to look for the easy questions or the easy marks, okay? Now, if you go to your information and if you go to the extract from the statement of financial position, let's first put in what we have been given, okay? Let's first put in what we have been given. Now, you know we are working with the ordinary share capital note. There we go. Okay. So, here are two amounts that they gave us. May I remind you that 2021, this column, all these amounts are your opening balances. It's your opening balances. And the 2022 column, all these amounts are your closing balances, right? Now, if we look at this note, we know that the number of shares goes in this column and our rand value goes into this column, and then we're going to just give a little bit of information there in the middle. Now, I just informed you that I have two rand values that were literally given to me. So it's a situation of copy and paste. Copy and paste. Easy, two easy marks there already for you. So we're going to start off by just reminding ourselves here at the bottom. This is ordinary shares. In issue at the end of the year. Sorry, I'm squeezing it in there for you. And that rand amount, like I said, we already have it. So we're going to put that in 2,536,000. So we have that, yes, our first mark. And then we go up, and this first amount over here, the opening balance, what are they looking for? Ordinary shares in issue at the beginning of the year. We have the number of shares, but we don't have the rand value. But here they give us the rand value. So we're going to fill it in, 1,440,000. And there we have it. Already two marks, easy, 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 right? But we tend to think, oh, no, I can't do this. But you can, you can, you can. There are so many easy marks, but we don't look for them. Okay, now I'm going to take you back. I'm going to take you back to our notes over here. The share capital. The authorized share capital consists of 500,000 ordinary shares. Now, what is authorized share capital? And I know you're shouting it out. You're saying those are the amount of shares that the company can issue. But they usually issue it over a certain period of time. Okay? They tell me here that 2,880,000 ordinary shares were in issue before the 1st of September 2021. And we know that because we already have it here in our note, right? Then they carry on and they say, on the 30th of June 2022, the directors decided to repurchase 144,000 ordinary shares for 1.10 per share, or as you know it, 1.10. Now, learners, please, 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 please bear in mind that you should now think of things this way. As the company, we now need to get money together to pay for these shares that we repurchased. There are two places that we are going to get that money, right? So first of all, let's see, how much money do we need? We need, it's going to be 144,000. 144,000 multiplied by 1.10, right? We need 158,400. Now, this money needs to come from somewhere. It's two places that it's going to come from, right? Our ordinary share capital note. That's where it's going to come from, and our retained income. But in this case, I'm not interested in the retained income. I'm interested in ordinary share capital amount. What amount must I take from the ordinary share capital amount? Now, please do not forget that this is your repurchase price, first of all. This is your repurchase price, and we are going to make use of the average share price. The average share price. Now you're like, oh my goodness, yes, oh no, I know that. Ma'am, but I'm a little bit rusty. Can you remind me? Yes, I will remind you how we get that. First of all, you will see that after these shares that were an issue at the beginning of the financial year, we did not issue additional shares. We repurchased shares immediately. Okay? We repurchased shares immediately. Now, it might happen that you issue new shares first. Then you will take that average of the shares at the beginning of the year plus the additional shares issued. But in this case, we only have those two amounts to help us work out the average share price. And I'm going to give you a minute because I'm very sure someone is already shouting it out. Maybe someone here in my own class, I have a few of my learners here, maybe they can beat, it seems like the heroes of the day are Delft. Maybe they can beat Delft, but I'm sure Delft is on it today because my learners look like they're a little bit sleepy. so I'm going to give you a chance. Maybe we can beat you, Delft. I'm going to give you 1 minute for that. Okay, learners, so it seems like we are taking our time, but it's okay. Let's quickly, let me quickly go through it with you. Okay, so guys, what are we going to do over here? We are literally going to do the following. I'm going to just go back to my screen for you. Right, we are going to make use of these two amounts, right? How do we get our average share price? We are going to take our rand value of shares in issue. Okay, over our number of shares. Okay, so we're going to say 1,440,000 over the number of shares. going to divide it by the number of shares, and that's going to give you 50 cents, right? It's going to give you 50 cents. So the average share price is 50 cents in this case. It's 50 cents. So that is all I'm going to take over here, and out of the ordinary share capital is 50 cents multiplied by 144,000. So we know we are taking 144,000 is not going to be in issue anymore, right? So it's going to come back to us. It's not out there in the public anymore. And we know we are repurchasing it. At 50 cents, and that's going to give us an amount of 72,000. I'm sure everybody got this. I'm very sure of it. And then we're going to move on. We're going to move on because I don't want to waste your time. I quickly want to give you a few minutes break because I mean it's a long morning. So let's quickly see. Let's move on. So remember now, we got that. It is 50 cents and we are happy. We don't have to work that out now. Why? Because we don't need to do the retained income note. But please take note that the difference in this case between the repurchase price and the average share price is 60 cents. Okay? If you were wondering, it's 60 cents. Okay, so what do they say here? On the 1st of August 2022, the company issued. So now the company is giving out more shares. Why? Because we are in need of some more funds. So new shares were issued, but obviously for a little bit more of 125 cents. And these shareholders qualify for the final dividend. So easy peasy, again, easy marks. And we're not going to deduct now. We're going to add. Because remember, these shares are going out to the public. And it is new shares, new issue. Or shares issued, whatever you are comfortable with, at R1.25. And that's going to give me an amount of 1,168,000. And remember, it's not in brackets. We are adding it. So we can quickly add up and subtract this to get our answer. So I'm going to start with the number of shares at the beginning of the year. I'm going to deduct my repurchase and I'm going to add the new shares. And that's going to give me 3,670,400. Please, this amount, we're going to make use of it a little bit later on. Learners, I'm literally going to give you 10 minutes. Can we say a little bit longer? Shall we say 12 minutes break that you can quickly run to the bathroom, maybe drink a little bit of water, have a chat with your friends, and we will see each other back here in 12 minutes. Okay, awesome. I hope you're learning and I hope you are seeing those easy marks that is going to get you confident and get you through. Okay, guys, see you in a few minutes. So we're going to move on and we're going to move to this page over here. Okay, now you will see this question, they ask you the face of the cash flow statement. And because they ask you the face of the cash flow statement, you need to know your format. You need to know your format, and you will also have to do calculations in brackets. That is also why you'll see with this activity the space, there's quite a bit of space for you to do your necessary calculations. Now, I'm very sure by now you know that the cash flow statement also has a few notes, and I'm sure you've come across it as you go through your past question papers, where they ask you to do the reconciliation note, or they ask you to do the dividends paid or the taxation paid. And then, of course, I'm sure you also seen that you had to calculate the net change in cash and cash equivalents. And that is usually this little piece here at the bottom. What can also happen is they can ask you just this part, or they can just ask you this part or this part. Okay, so we know that the cash flow statement is divided up into three main activities: the operating activities, the investing activities, and our financing activities. And this entire statement is all about cash. So I used to say to my previous classes, my previous years of matric, shasha, okay? We like money, 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 only money, yeah. Now, just a little tip that I want to give you. Please, learners, you will see that there is a block over here, and it is in gray. Please do not waste your time to try and work this out. You're going to waste your time, and you are possibly going to lose marks because you're putting things in that is unnecessary and that could possibly just confuse you. So only focus on what is required and what has been asked of you. Okay, so what I would like you to do first is we are going to first fill in this format. Okay, now what usually happens in the investing activities, we are going to work with fixed assets that we have purchased. Fixed assets that we have purchased. Okay, fixed asset purchased. Then in this activity specifically, there was proceeds from asset disposal. And of course, in this case, there is an increase in financial assets. Or it could have been a decrease, but in this case, there was an increase. In financial assets. Okay. You must just give me one moment over here. I see my learners are not able to see in class. I do apologize. I just want to quickly sort this out. And please do not judge me for my very busy desktop. I do apologize. Okay. Okay, there we go. Now we can go back. I do apologize, learners and colleagues. Okay, so let's first deal with this little section. So like I said, we're going to take it piece by piece. We're not going to rush through all of it. We're going to take it piece by piece. Okay, so fixed assets purchased. So let's go and see what occurred in our fixed assets. And I actually made a note over here because when we look at this word, what does that tell you? Now, remember, we all thinking and working with the inflow and the outflow, the inflow and the outflow of money. When we purchase something, that means there's going to be an outflow. So immediately go and put your little brackets in, okay? Go and put your brackets in. And we can actually go a little bit further and we can say proceeds from asset disposal. Now, proceeds means that there's an inflow. There's money going to come in. So we're not going to have any brackets over here, right? Next up, an increase in financial assets. An increase in financial assets. Okay? An increase in financial assets. And what that means is we are basically taking money out of our bank account and investing some more money. Do not forget, it's also part of investing activities. So the money that we put aside for our fixed deposit, we are putting more money aside for our fixed deposit. And because we are increasing the financial assets, it means that we are taking money out of our cash flow, right? So that will mean it's also going to be in brackets because there's going to be a outflow, okay? Right, so let's quickly see. We are going to first look at the fixed assets purchase. And I want to ask you to make a note over here. At the fixed assets purchase, right, you need to know your note 3. Know your note 3. And what note 3 am I talking about? I'm talking about the fixed asset note. Now, let's go and think about this. First of all, we have a lot of information over here that was given to us. We have the fixed assets at carrying value. So we're going to make use of these amounts, right? We're going to make use of these amounts. And I'm going to go and look where else did they give me some information regarding fixed assets. So we know we're going to make use of these amounts. We are going to make use of the depreciation. Okay, right. And we are also going to make use of the information here at the back. There they gave me a bit of information. Equipment, carrying value, there we go. And then equipment cost. So they say here, equipment was sold at carrying value. So what did they say here? The equipment cost 216,000. So that's the original cost price. And the accumulated depreciation was 132,000. Now, how do I get the carrying value? How do I get carrying value? It is my cost price minus my accumulated depreciation. Okay, so I'm going to say 216,000, right? And I'm going to subtract the 132,000. That's going to give me 84,000 rand. Now, why did I say here, know your note 3? Know your node 3. Why did I say that? Because you will notice in node 3, we show disposal at carrying value, and it is usually in brackets. So we need to take that into account when we do this calculation. So first of all, you are going to start with your amount over here. You are going to start with this this opening balance, of course, 2,532,000. I'm going to open my bracket, apologies. 2,532,000. I am going to deduct what? My depreciation. There we go, 309,000. Okay. And remember, I am going to deduct that disposal at carrying value as per my Note 3 format. So that was the 84,000 that we worked out. And last but not least, I am going to deduct my closing balance. 3552000. Now, let's say, for example, you only remember to take this amount and deduct that amount. That's already 2 marks. That's already 2 marks. So, learners, again, these are your easier marks. This is actually also an easy mark because it's given to you. This is the only mark that we need to do a little bit of a calculation. So even if you have those 3 correct, you already have 3 marks. You already have 3 marks. So that is already a plus for you, and that is where I want you to build your confidence. Because I know you are telling yourself, oh, that's not so difficult. I just went and I looked, where are all my amounts that has to do with my fixed assets? And already you saw there are 2 easy marks for you there. You are going to find that your amount of a year is 1,413,000. I hope everybody agrees with that. Now, they want to know, what were my proceeds from selling this asset? Now, remember, we sold it for carrying value. So basically, this would be your proceeds. But just to save face, you are going to show it in brackets. There we go. And that gives you 84,000 Rand. Right. Okay. I'm going to quickly throw it back into your court. And let's see who can, 30 seconds, maybe a minute. I want to know who is going to be able to show me what was the increase in the financial asset. You are more than welcome to type it in the chat, or you can raise your hand. Guys and girls, let's quickly go and see what does our information tell us. Now, we know that a fixed deposit is a financial asset. So let's go and look at our opening balance of the fixed deposit, and we compare it with our closing balance. So you're going to see with the cash flow statement, there's a lot of comparing that occurs, okay? So our financial year started with us having 200,000 Rand invested. And the financial year ended with us having 588,420 invested. So the difference between that two, that is the outflow of money. So remember, we have to take money out of our own bank account and invested in a fixed deposit, and we are hoping, obviously, that it grows with a very lovely interest rate. Okay? And remember, it's an investing activity. So let's quickly just show that in brackets. I'm going to deduct the one from the other. 588,420 minus the 200,000, and that is going to give us 388,420. Okay, right, look at that. That first little piece, we have a little bit more confidence in it, and we know now that should we get only this little piece in the exam, we can confidently take it on and get those easy marks. Next step, I would like you to add these two amounts together. So add the negative 1,413,000 plus the negative 388,000, and then we're going to subtract the 84,000. But yes, you are right. The amount will remain negative. Okay? That amount, when you calculate it, you will find that it is 1,717,420. Okay, good stuff. Now let's move on. Let's move on. We are almost there with this cash flow statement, and I'm sure some of you have actually gone further than what I already am. But let's see where we are now. Now, first of all, again, I'm first going to run through the format of this activity. First of all, in this activity, we have, and usually you will have, proceeds. Of shares issued. Okay, good stuff. And again, let's look at these words. Proceeds, meaning that we are getting money in. Money is flowing in, it is an inflow. So our amount over here will not be in brackets, it will be without brackets. Now let's go and see what information did they give us here. Let's quickly go and look at that. So we're going to go to our information over here. Remember, you can actually go back to your note, because remember, this was indicated in the note, in the ordinary share capital note. So we can make a little note for you there. Look at ordinary share capital, right? You just did it. We just did it together. So we're going to go over here. New shares issued at 1,25 rand, and there's our amount. That is the money that came in, 1,168,000. How did I get it? I'm going to show it in my brackets as well. It is the 934,400 number of shares multiplied with 1,25 rand. Close the bracket, giving us the 1,168,000. Okay, good stuff. That is also an easy one. Why am I saying that? Because you can literally copy and paste from what you did in the note. Right, moving on. Also, what happens in the financing activities is we need to indicate the repurchase, right? The repurchase of shares. And again, what am I going to tell you? I'm going to go and tell you specifically in this activity, look at ordinary share capital. Because why? We already calculated it there to an extent. Why am I saying to an extent? Remember, we use the average share price. We cannot use the average share price in this calculation. Why not? Because here we're going to make use of the repurchase price. So again, I'm going to make a little note for you. Use repurchase price. If that helps you, you know, when I teach, I make all these notes to my learners, and most of the time they write down the notes. So I'm hoping you're going to also write down my notes today. So I'm going to write this in brackets. Remember, we repurchased 144,000, and we are going to multiply it with the repurchase price of 1 rand and 10 cents. Okay, and that will give me the total amount of money that we spent to repurchase these shares. And again, repurchase. I am purchasing. So money is flowing out. There's your bracket. It's going to give you 158,400. Okay, right. Last but not least. Also at financing activities, learners, remember one of the ways that we can finance a company is by taking out a loan. Now, when we increase the loan, that is obviously more money coming in. However, when we pay back the loan, that is money flowing out. But again, we must know our format. So let's go see. This information that needs to go over here is going to be regarding the loan. And it's usually the long-term loan. So let's quickly go and see, and we're going to go and look at our information. Aha, here we go. Again, we're going to look at the differences. We're going to look at the differences. So there is your loan, right? At the beginning of the year, we owed 750,000 rand. Now, at the end of the financial year, we only owe 350. So the question is, what happened between the beginning and the end of the year? A payment occurred to the value of 400,000. And that's literally what we're going to write down. So we're going to say repayment. And we are going to, in our little brackets, and I know you're going to say, oh, ma'am, I can easily calculate that. I know you can, but you might get part marks. So do it anyway. We're going to subtract the opening balance from the closing balance, and there you will see your difference of 400,000. Yes, guys, I think we are winning, and I hope at this point in time you are again feeling more confident, because like I mentioned, this little piece over here, just this little piece, could be asked in the exam, okay? Or, like I said, the entire cash flow statement can be asked. But now you are ready, regardless. So what do we do now? We're going to add those two amounts together, my two positive amounts, and then I'm going to subtract the repurchase. Excuse me, this is also a negative. Ay, ay, ay. Apologies. That's also a negative. So we're going to take our 1,168,000. We're going to subtract those two amounts, and we are going to put our amount here at the top. That's going to give you 609600. I hope we are all getting the same amounts and that you are winning and that you realize that you can do this. Right, next up, last little piece. Again, learners, this specific little piece has been asked in numerous past question papers, right? So don't look over it, don't leave it. You have done it, you have prepared yourself, so you will can definitely do this. So what can we do over here? Look, we can do the following. We can now make use of our three amounts over here. We can make use of the cash flow from operating activities. There we go. And we're going to make use of this amount. Okay. And we're going to make use of this amount. Okay. So what do I do here? I'm going to do the following. I'm going to add these two amounts together, the positives. That's going to give me 1222 plus 609600, giving me 1,813,020. But now don't forget, the investing activities is in brackets, so I need to deduct that from this amount, okay? So I subtract the 1,717,420, and there we go. I have an amount here, and it is positive, 595,600. Okay, what is left for me to do? I want to know what was my cash and cash equivalents at the beginning of the financial year. So I know what was the net change, right? We were able to calculate that. And the cash and cash equivalents at the end of the year was given. So I want to know what happened at the beginning of the year. Now remember, we end up with this amount. So that tells me that there was a negative. So we're going to subtract the one from the other. There was a negative, meaning there was an overdraft. Okay, there was an overdraft, and that will be 83,000 on the dots. So there was a negative. Okay, good stuff, everybody. I hope this has made you more confident in the cash flow statement itself. And again, learners, you know which part of this cash flow statement you have come across where it was a little bit more challenging. Let's say it was the investing activities. Go re-practice this. And now you have the actual memo here in front of you. Maybe it was or is the financing activities. Go and re-look at that. Or maybe it was your net change in cash and cash equivalents. But I really hope you feel a little bit more confident and that you realize that it is doable. Okay, let's move on. Now, I told you that we are going to look at some calculations, our financial indicators. And I just want to quickly remind you of something. When I did the winter school, and I think most of you joined the winter school, I shared this with you. Now, I just want to share it again. I just want to bring it up to my screen. I don't know if Mrs. Moyse was still with us then. I don't know if she shared it with the teachers. But I'm just going to quickly remind you of this. So I hope you can see it. I made it quite colorful. It is almost like a little cheat sheet. But obviously, you can't take this with you. But it is a lovely way for you to remember your financial indicators and which formulas, which calculations goes with which question. So if you look, for example, I say here that at the end of the day, there are a few questions that needs to be answered. Someone might ask you, what is the profitability of this company or business? Then you should know that these indicators here, any one of them, will be able to tell you what the profitability of the company is. Okay. Now, in this case, they want us to work out the return on average equity. So that has to do, and it's a new financial indicator to you, that has to do with my returns. So excuse me, let's just double check. Yes, it has to do with my returns. So I'm very sure most of you received this. If not, I can try and make a plan to get it to you. But it's really useful when you also practice and prepare for the exams. Okay, so let's go back to it. I'm going to put the ball in your court now. I am going to ask you to quickly work out number. Let's give you a little bit of a challenge. I am going to ask you to work out for me the percentage return on average equity. Okay. On your marks, get set, go. I'm going to give you 2 minutes. Let's see who is the fastest finger. Hi, sir. You are more than welcome to maybe just leave that for me. What I'll do is I'll send you my email address, and then you can just pop me an email, and then I really don't mind forwarding that cheat sheet to you. I'm going to leave my email, my school email address, and you are welcome to just contact me. Just a friendly reminder again, colleagues, do not forget about the registration. It will be much appreciated. Thank you. So nobody is going to give me an answer here. Mr. De Beer, you guys are very quiet. Castles Flay. Okay. Buren, you guys are also very quiet. You close to me. You're welcome. Okay, but let's move on. It seems like everybody is still in holiday mode. So let's move on. Okay, Lena, so as I mentioned, this is really where you can get those easy marks, okay? And again, you see, the thing is, the beauty of these financial indicators, you are given a formula sheet. But unfortunately, if you don't know which name goes with what formula, you are going to struggle. Because remember, these names are not given with the formulas. It's only the formulas that are given to you on the formula sheet. So it is crucial that you know the names to formulas, okay? And that is why I'm going to share that cheat sheet with any of your teachers that email me. I am going to share it with you. It is even color-coded. Okay, so let's remind ourselves over here. So they want us to calculate the following financial indicators for the year. The percentage return on average equity. Now, percentage return on average owner's equity. We are going to first, I'm going to just remind you here in the corner of that formula. Okay. It is my net profit after tax over my average shareholder's equity. Now, how do I get average? And what exactly is shareholder's equity made up of? Shareholder's equity is made up of the ordinary share capital plus the retained income. But now, be careful, because it's not just for 1 year. We have information for 2 years. So we need to go and get that average, right? How do I get the average? I literally take all those amounts, I add it together, and I divide it by 2 or multiply with 1/2. Okay, so where do I get this information? You're going to see, once again, here in your information over here, at the extract, the financial statement of financial position, you're going to see here is the information that I need, okay? So I'm going to take these two, and I'm going to take these two amounts. And we are going to add it all together, and we're going to divide it with 1/2, or divide it by 2, apologies, and multiply it by 1/2 if you are looking for the average, okay? I do apologize. I've got a bit of a runny nose. Okay, so let's quickly do this. Now, first of all, remember they want a percentage, right? They want a percentage. So we know we need to multiply with 100/1, okay? Because we are looking for a percentage. Now, let's first go and do our net profit after tax. Now, interesting, they give me the income tax, which is equal to 28%. We are looking for the net profit after tax. Okay? And we're going to actually apply what we learned earlier in our income statement over here. So the net profit after tax is equal to 72%, basically, okay? And this is the one we're looking for. So once again, we're going to work with what we want over what we have. I'm going to just quickly do this calculation for you. What we want is the 72%. We have the 28%, and we have an amount available of 672,000. Okay. So let's quickly work this out. You're going to say 72 divided by 28 multiplied by 672. And we have 1,000,000 728,000. That will be your net asset value, net profit after tax. So here's your net profit after tax, 1,728,000. Okay? And just that is equal to, I think it's two. No, it's only one mark. Okay, because they want you, they know you're clever. So they're only going to give you one mark. But that's one mark that you can do because we learned about it a little bit earlier. And I know you have worked through a number of question papers where you have seen something similar. Now we're going to use the other information. So like I said, we're going to make use of these amounts. Let's first start with our, it doesn't matter what you write down first, as long as it's all there, right? So let's start with our opening balances. Okay. First of all, we know we need to multiply it with a half. Okay. So we're going to write that half in. And we are going to start with our ordinary share capital at the beginning of the year. So it's 1,440,000 plus the retained income of 823,680. So that these two amounts is for 2021. Just want to help you out a little bit here because I know it's quite a large calculation. But it is 6 marks that I know you want to get. Then we're also going to add the amounts for 2022. So we're going to say 2,536,000, right, plus the 1,457,600 of the retained income. And we're going to close our bracket. And just to remind you, these are the two amounts for 2022. Right, guys, I'm just going to add in over here just a little step because I don't just want to go to the second step. I want to show you exactly where I get these amounts. Because remember now, we want you to get as many marks as you possibly can. So this is how we got that amount. And if you use all the space, but you write neatly, no marker will be upset with you as long as you just write neatly, okay? So let's quickly get this amount together. So it's 1,728 at the top. And at the bottom, after we've done all the necessary calculations, you're going to find you're going to be left with 3,128,640. Now, learners, don't stop there. Remember, you need to still multiply it with 100 over 1. Because why? We're looking for a percentage. And it's so important that you show your percentage. And also, many times learners ask me, okay, but what about the decimals? What about the commas? That instruction will be given to you at the beginning of your question paper where you have your instructions that is given to you at the beginning of the question paper. So make sure you do read through it because there they will indicate to you how many decibel marks or how many decibel amounts after the decimal you must use, or you know what I mean, okay? You know what I mean. So please do take note of that. But in this case, it is 55.2%. That is my answer. So there we go. That is 6 marks. 6 marks, learners. Don't shy away. Do this. It's just, even if you don't get all of it right, I know there are parts of this calculation that you could easily get right, even if it's just half. So 3 out of 6, that is already 50% for this question. Okay? Okay, right, let's move on. Net asset value per share. How do we get this? Now, I told you that we are going to make use of some of this information a little bit later on. Okay, we're going to make use of some of this information. And I am going to quickly remind you of the formula. It is my owner's shareholder's equity. Apologies, Lulu. Shareholder's equity over my number of shares in issue. And right, this will obviously be for the year that we are currently busy with. Okay, so that will be for 2022. So we are going to make use of the 2022 amounts over year, right? So we're going to add those two together because that will give me the shareholders' equity for 2022. And together it gives me 393,600. Okay, and I already know what is the number of shares in issue. Now, I just page back and I go and see. Ah, okay, there we go. Number of shares in issue at the end of the financial year. There is my 3,670,400. Quickly going to jot it down, 367,400. Okay. And net asset value per share is not percentage, it is in cents. So I want my answer in cents. You're going to be left with your answer. And apologies, do not forget to multiply it with 100. So just because I'm multiplying with 100 doesn't mean it's going to be percent. It needs to be in cents because it's the asset net, it's the value per share. And that value needs to be in a rand or a cents value. Okay. So we're going to be left with 108 cents, comma 8. I am very sure you will be forgiven if you, no, you won't be forgiven. Because remember, like I just said, you need to stick to the instructions given to you regarding the decimal points. Okay, guys, again, that is an easy 3 marks. Why is it going to be easy for you? Because you're going to know your formulas. And you're going to know your formats, because I'm sure you've noticed if you know your formats, it's very easy to go and get these amounts. It's very easy. You will know exactly where to look. Okay, guys, time to move on. You're probably saying, oh, thank goodness, ma'am. I'm so tired of question one questions. Finally, we can move on to question paper two questions. And yes, we can. I'm very excited to tell you that today we are going to look at the following two questions. And learners, believe it or not, we are going to go through this so quickly because it's so easy. And you're going to be like, why didn't I do this? Why didn't I believe in myself? Because I know after this session, you're going to have so much more confidence to take on these questions when the question paper arrives. Okay, so here we go. They want us to do a bank reconciliation in this activity. Now, learners, please note, you can either get a bank reconciliation, a debtors reconciliation, a creditors reconciliation, or a debtors age analysis. Now, I'm going to also be able to, hopefully, with my time, I think I will be able to do it. I'll be able to run through a debtor's age analysis with you as well. If there were ever easy marks, that is the place. Okay, but we're going to go through this, and I know you're going to enjoy it because truly bank reconciliation is one of the easiest things, but you must just grasp it. Okay, right. So here in front of us, they ask us the following. Slogan traders, the following information relates to slogan traders for May 2023. The official bank statement from UK Bank is issued on the 28th of each month. Now, just a friendly reminder, why are there things missing? Why don't our bank statement and our books always add up? Because remember, a business goes to the end of each month. We keep track till the end of each month. So let's say till the 28th, if it was February, it would have been easy. But all the other months usually goes to the 30th or the 31st. So therefore, those few days, that is information that the bank doesn't have as of yet. And we also don't have that piece of the bank statement. And at the end of the day, what I want to remind you of is the bank reconciliation is really, that statement that we are compiling is really a continuation of the bank statement. It is a continuation of the bank statement. I also want to remind you that there are two options that you will get in the exam. And I want you to do the bank reconciliation statement option that you feel most confident in. You're going to see there is a bank reconciliation statement with two columns, and then there's a bank reconciliation statement with one column. Now, learners, it depends on what your teacher taught you, and I'm sure he or she gave you the option to do what you are comfortable with. So please look out for that should you get possibly a bank reconciliation question at the end of the year. Okay, let's go further. Now, they want us to complete the cash journals. So that means the CRJ and the CPJ. Calculate the correct bank balance. Now, over here, with this correct bank balance, you can either do a T account, or you can just do a normal calculation. And then here, of course, prepare the bank reconciliation statement. And if we have time, we will look at the 5.1.4. Right. Now, let's go to our information. What I've noticed again, even with my own learners, reading. We don't read. The answer, most of the time, is right in front of us, but we don't read because we want to rush. So let's quickly see. Some information, the extract from the bank reconciliation statement on the 30th of April. So basically, this is the bank reconciliation statement that we compiled at the end of April. But now we need to do the books for May 2023. Okay? You will see they gave you some notes here. And some of you might have seen a similar question, or you might have done a bank reconciliation that is similar. But let's quickly see. The outstanding deposit of $24,400 on the bank reconciliation statement was in respect of sales. It also did not appear on the bank statement for May. An investigation revealed that the bookkeeper never deposited the money. Now, here I can give you a little tip. When they give you something like this, I can tell you now they are going to ask you an ethical or internal control question a little bit later. It was decided to write off the deposit. Now, I want you to think of this. Originally, this deposit was from, or it was indicated in the CRJ originally. Now they want us to write off the deposit. So we basically need to cancel this deposit. Why? Because it was never deposited. We never got the money. Okay? So unfortunately, we cannot tick that 24,400 rand off over here because we still have not received it. But we do have to cancel it in the CBJ. So what I want us to do first is I want us to first work through all of this and then we quickly enter everything in. I know we'll have enough time because you are very smart and you're going to pick up on this very quickly. Now they say further on, the outstanding deposit of 36,600 appeared on the bank statement for May 2023. So it's not a problem for us anymore. It is sorted out. It is there. We are happy. We can move on. And then as well, the EFT for 321 appeared on the May 2023 bank statement. So goody, done, done and dusted, out of our way. If we move on, you will see the provisional totals from the cash journals. Now remember, we basically need to update, we need to make new cash journals, but we need to start with these amounts. So this is nothing new to you. We must start with these amounts. Usually it is given to you in the answer sheet, which you will see now, but just so that you know, we must start with these. Okay, moving on. Moving on. Okay, there we go. Now, learners, yeah. Oh, goodness, yeah. And I think all your teachers are saying, yes, ma'am, yeah. Okay, so I want you to take note of this. The following information on the May 2023 bank statement received from UK Bank. So basic what they're saying is this information was on the bank statement. Now let's remind ourselves, the bank statement, whose records are those? Those are the bank's records. Okay, it's the bank's records. Did not appear in the journals. Aha, there they tell me. It did not appear in my books. So what do I need to do? I need to fill in my CRJ and my CPJ. I need to update. My new CRJ and CPJ. So it did not appear where in the journals, which is my records, okay, or our records. So it is, you're going to miss out so much if you don't read properly, okay? So all of these items, most of them, we need to update. Okay, the journals, right, okay. Let's quickly run through them, let's see. I'm sure you're going to shout it out for me. Okay, a direct payment, there we go. First tip, payment appeared on the bank statement. This was the final repayment of the loan. So where that does that go? CPJ. Needs to be updated in our new CPJ. A deposit from M. Martin for 14,500 for her monthly rent. A deposit is something we as the business receive. So yes, CRJ. Next up, EFT 444, 13,200 was paid to Jamie Traders for trading stock. Okay, After an investigation, it was discovered that the bookkeeper neglected to record it. So, guys, hello. We are paying, so that is a CPJ. Right? And this is also the type of things that you can read through in that 10 minutes of reading time that you get. Then moving on, there they give us some fees. Basically, all these guys are bank costs or charges, whatever you want to call it. It's either bank costs or bank charges. Okay? We literally add those guys together, and that will give us our bank cost. And again, it's costs. So that means it's CPJ, right? The only thing that we cannot add to our bank costs is interest. Now, interest can be on a negative bank balance, or interest can be on a positive bank balance. If the interest is on a positive bank balance, right? That means we are getting money. CRJ, yes, more money for us. If we move on, debit orders. Debit orders, as a business, you give permission for the bank to deduct money from your account to pay for, in this case, insurance and water and electricity. Both these are expenses, right? And we need to pay them. Or in some cases, it could be payments, if you think of cash payments journal, right? So those two need to go where? Cash payments journal. Next up, EFT 4274 or 474, excuse me, payment for 5,262 was in favor of silver, but again, payment, right? The bank duplicated this EFT in the bank account. The bank will rectify this error. Now, this error will therefore be rectified where? I'm sure someone can shout it out for me, but it will be rectified in in the bank reconciliation statement. Let's double check. They will rectify it, but obviously we need to also just put that in. Oh yes, it will be going to the bank recon statement. I'm so sorry, I double read. I read something else. And then paid the creditor. Paid. Again, guys, hello. There is so many keywords for you here that we don't want you to miss out on. Paid the creditor electronically. 13,000 or 14,300 for settlement of the account. So, CPJ. Last but not least, the bank, a bank error of 7,900 was reflected as a deposit. So when they reflect it as a deposit, it is on the credit side. Remember, of the bank statement. It's just the opposite of that what we are used to. The bank will rectify the error. So it 7,900 was reflected as a deposit when it should have been a debit. Okay? So all that we're going to do is we're going to write it on the debit side of the bank reconciliation statement, right? Take note of that. And last but not least, guys, again, and I know your teachers are saying, yes, ma'am, again. Here we go again. The following information appeared in the May 2023 cash journals. Okay, there we go. This is our records. So it was in our records. But what? It was not in theirs. Did not appear on the bank statement. So therefore, these guys, where will they go? And I know you're shouting, bank recon statement. Guys, I hope that just opens your eyes a little bit, because I mean, this, just that first bold print above all of this information should already open your eyes. I am going to give you literally 5 minutes. I want you to quickly go and fill in these guys. Now, how nice is this? It's not a full CRJ and CPJ. It is literally where they tell you, they give you that provisional totals that we discussed earlier. They give you that over there. So those are the amounts, provisional totals. Literally, it's given to you over there, okay? And they only want the amounts. They don't want you to write any description. They only want you to write the amounts. I'm going to give you 5 minutes. So like I said, we went through this information, and clearly, I'm very sure that you took note of the 14,500. Yes, you are right if you took note of that. So 14,500. Okay, cool stuff. And you took note of the interest on the positive bank balance. Yes, great stuff. 216 rand. Now, learners, for some reason, and I'm sure your teachers might have also come across it, you don't have to give us any signals here. So don't write any minus or plus or minus. None of that is necessary. You only have to give us the figure, okay? You only have to give us the figure. So there we go. So our cash receipts journal, we have a total of 246746. So learners, do not forget, you cannot just add those two amounts. You also need to add your provisional total. Okay, that's easy stuff. Guess what? Those are 2 marks already. 2 marks in your pocket. Easy, easy. Okay, let's move on to our cash payments journal. We have a few over here. First of all, that 108,000, let's write that in. I'm going to write it in with black this time. Okay. Then we must not forget about the information that we wrote down earlier with our 24,400. So remember, we need to cancel it. That's why it's going to the CPJ. So there we go. 24,400. Already 3 marks in your pocket. Already 3 marks in your pocket. Right. And again, 13,200 was paid. There we go. Okay, it's easy. I'm sure you have already added up all these bank costs. All those together will give you 1,502 rand, right? You can write it separately or you can write it as one, but just bear in mind the space is limited. So rather write it as one, please. 1,502. That's your bank costs. So we've done with that guy. Next up, my debit orders. 7,800 for insurance. So we're going to add that. Why? Because it's a payment that I made. Last but not least, my water and electricity. 5,760. Good stuff. And last but not least, can you believe it? Why do I feel like I've missed something? Did I miss something? I don't think so. Ah, here we go. Here we go. Paid paid the creditor electronically, 14,300 for the settlement of the account. Okay, so again, paid. So we know that is also paid, giving us 14,300. Okay, right. 14,300. And what do we get at the end of the day? We are going to add those guys together, right? We're going to add those guys together and we are going to get a total of 277,462. Yes, I'm sure you did that. I am very sure you did that. I'm going to give you literally a minute because we have a few minutes left. I'm going to give you a minute that you just quickly get me that bank balance, that new bank balance. And thank you so much. I see my colleague has already provided you with a feedback form. Thank you so much. Colleagues, we have a few minutes to go. Let's just use all our time and then we can take a rest. Okay. 1 minute. If somebody wants to quickly be so quick to give us that bank balance, that will be much appreciated. Okay, guys, here we go. Here we go. Nobody wants to give me an answer. Oh, my goodness. Even Excelsior, I also see you here today. You're way too quiet. Way too quiet. Okay, I'm going to quickly give you the answers over here, learners. Now, remember, these guys you are going to use. You are going to make use of these guys, right? Let's say for some reason, you made an error. You maybe missed one of these amounts or you placed one of these amounts over here and vice versa. Please, learners, don't lose your confidence. Take those same amounts that you calculated and use them over here. Now, you will see they asked me earlier, right, for the favorable balance as per the bank account. They get it was just left blank. There was a question mark. So what did I do? I said, so remember credit balance on the bank statement. So on the bank statement, a credit balance is good. So it's positive. 9,500, a deposit. That deposit didn't go through. Let's just see. And then another one. And then we subtract the guy. Yes. Okay. So just a reminder, You're going to start with 9,500. This is one column. You are going to add, and then you're going to subtract, and then you will find your favorable balance as per the bank account. Okay? Favorable balance as per the bank account. And in this case, it is worked out to 32,600. Now remember, the cash receipts journal, this is money that you received, right? So you're going to add it. That goes into your bank account, right? And you made payments. That's your total payments. So that's leaving your bank account. Okay? 277,462. And finally, the amount you are looking for is 1,884. Now, learners, before you go any further, take that very amount. And remember, it is a debit balance, right? It's a debit balance. It's good. It's positive. You're literally going to copy and paste. We just worked it out. So why not copy and paste? So we're going to write here at the bottom, debit balance of the bank recon, debit balance as per bank account. And again, I want you to know that even though, let's say for some reason you got this one wrong, and this one isn't rightly calculated, but you carried the same amount over, you are getting method marks, learners. So even if you calculated this wrong, take this amount, copy and paste, because that's another method mark, because it shows us as your teachers and as the markers in the final exam that you understand that this amount must go to the bank reconciliation statement, whether you calculated it correctly or not. So do yourself that favor. So I'm going to quickly copy and paste 1884. There we go. So there is your answer. You are more than welcome to put it in a T account. I'm just going to quickly show you the T account. Remember, it's a positive balance. So 32,600 over here. The CRJ amount over here. And then you just work out your balance. Whatever you are comfortable with. We don't want to prescribe to you, but we do want to make you comfortable with whatever you are comfortable with. Learners, I literally have 3 minutes. 3 minutes. So I'm going to quickly just fill in here for you. And the balance according to the bank statement. Now you will see they did not give this to us. They did not give this to us. So that means that is the balancing figure. That is the balancing figure. So it can either be on the debit or in the credit column. This will be your balancing figure. Okay. Right. So we know that there was an amount that was incorrectly credited, that amount being that EFT 474. And whose mistake was it? Was it ours? No. The bank duplicated the EFT. So the bank needs to rectify it. Okay? The bank needs to rectify it. So we are going to remind them of that. EFT incorrectly debited And that amount would be 5262. Again, learners, if you want to use the one column, you are welcome to use the one column. I'm going to quickly just write in the other incorrect amount, which was that 7,900. The bank error, again, it's their problem. It reflected as a deposit, but it should reflect as a debit as per the bank statement. So you're going to go and put that amount in the debit column. And again, incorrectly credited. Now, learners, I know my time has now run out. I'm going to stop here because I know you still have a long day. I want to tell you, I highly appreciate each one of you taking this time to spend with me this morning, and also for your sacrifice that you are making. I don't think you realize that the sacrifices you are making now, it's going to pay off at the end of the year. And as I'm saying this, my own learners are sitting here in front of me, and I'm hoping that as they hear me say it to many other schools and many other learners, that they will also take it to heart and realize that sacrifices will have to be made. Practice, practice, practice. Go through as many past question papers as you can. But I just want to wish you the best of luck, all my prayers for you and your teachers. And may it just be a successful final exam for all of us. And then I also just want to say, many of you are going to go to your matric dances. You must enjoy it. But remember, focus on the academics. Colleagues, I want to thank you for your time. And